I, the Nitpick Critic, has returned to review another movie. And that movie is... That's right! Tron, the next day short film. Oh, about my shirt? Well, I just wore that because it had the same Tron color palette.
Looking back. Short films serve a great deal in the film industry. Dating all the way back to the very beginning of movie making, short films have been the product of several filmmakers looking to make art, emphasize a theme, parody current culture, or just for the sheer imagination of it. Without these little features, some of the most profound filmmakers or movie concepts would not have been known today. It's really amazing, too, because some of these shorts look fairly good for their limited budgets. An example of this would be the big-budget Adam Sandler film Pixels from 2015. Originally, it was a 2-minute short film by Patrick Jean in 2010, but we all know what happened with that, and the rest is history. However, if it weren't for Jean's short film, Pixels may or may not have been amped up and made into a big special effects extravaganza. Believe it or not, short films have the power to create possible projects in the future and get people pumped for them. The same goes for this topic. Before Tron the Next Day short film was released, there was also a promo short film for the actual Tron Legacy film. That was shown at the 2009 Comic-Con, and that got people really excited.
Well, it just so happened to be that Patrick Jean's short film was just picked up by the wrong group of filmmakers.
Shorts can also be used as quasi-sequels to popular movies. Adi Shankar's 10-minute short called The Punisher Dirty Laundry in 2012 gained massive attention for its continuation of Thomas Jane as the Punisher, even though it was never an approved, quote-unquote, official sequel by Marvel Studios.
Okay, so I did wear the shirt for a reason, but don't tell me you wouldn't want to see the Punisher in a Tron suit.
Technically, the majority of fans who prefer Thomas Jane's version of the Punisher consider that to be the sequel, as short as it was. And just like Thomas Jane's The Punisher, Disney released Tron Legacy, a reboot-slash-sequel film to a popular property from the 1980s.
Yes, I am calling Dolph Lundgren's Punisher film the first in the series. I'm not saying you have to agree with me.
One must notice, though, their fates were both rather similar. Both were considered mixed bags by viewers and critics. Both had trouble recouping back their budget. And both received quasi-sequels in the form of a short film, and stopped right after that. It's actually quite a surprise when, after years of sluggish momentum, rumors floating around from actor Bruce Boxleitner, actors returning, and an official statement being made that finally filming would begin in late 2015, the Mouse House immediately pulled the plug, stating that they were canceling Tron Legacy's awaited sequel. So again, technically, this is really the only official sequel to Tron Legacy. And it may very well end there, too. It's quite astounding this short even resulted, because the credits don't even have one big-name producer attached. The three producers listed are Alexander Durbin, Brian Hall, and Christina Huang, who only have one or two things that stand out. Brian Hall has mainly experience as a production assistant, Christina Huang has been majority an uncredited title producer, and Alexander Durbin has had experience being a visual effects producer for movies like Minority Report and Argo.
Well, at least from that alone being said, it doesn't sound like this production had much of a leg to stand on. But you'd be wrong!
Overall plot and writing. The story to this short is exactly what the title suggests. The setting takes place right after the events of Tron Legacy, once Sam Flynn, played by Garrett Hedlund, had returned from the grid. How the way the direction is executed is another subject. Heading the film is Kurt Mattila, a filmmaker with only one theatrical production under his belt, that being Lies and Alibis in 2006. The rest of Mattila's experience is more towards short films. A year before, he would direct Avatar Spirits in 2010, a documentary short, and that's also how this film is presented, mainly. So it's safe to guess that Mattila's experience as a documentary filmmaker carried over into this production. Viewers are introduced to an unknown figure named Zack Attack.
What did, like, his 3-year-old cousin make that name up?
Who guides his listeners via narration about how and why he's the head of the Flynn Lives movement after Kevin Flynn's disappearance in 1989, played by Jeff Bridges. And that's according to what Tron Legacy's script explained. As this figure continues to speak, the movie will switch to documentary mode and give its viewers two different aspects to the story. The first aspect gives chronological timestamps to significant events that occurred after Kevin Flynn vanished. things like how NCOM became what it was before Tron Legacy and when Sam Flynn took over. The other key component to the storytelling is the documentary-style execution director Kurt Matilla brings to the table. That includes flashbacks,
old audio recordings,
and interviews with characters from the original Tron film in 1982, like Alan Bradley, played by Bruce Boxleitner, and Roy Ram Kleinberg, played by Dan Shore, and other civilians. The funny thing is, while watching this, is that for those who have seen the original Tron film and Tron Legacy, we know what happened to Kevin Flynn. Yet the only character to legitimately know where Kevin Flynn is in this short film is Flynn's son. Not even employees of NCOM know what happened to Flynn. It's the documentary-like direction that gives it such a weird feel and allows the script to have a dramatic irony. It's one thing when the viewer is separate from the experience, but now the movie actually pretends that all this happened within the same universe as the viewer.
I mean, the realization to this isn't life-changingly deep, but, feels pretty real.
The only real answer that isn't quite clear to this day was the popularity of Kevin Flynn. Was his video game Space Paranoids that magnetic? Was that what brought people so closely together and formed this movement for Flynn?
If so, that is a bit overhyped.
You know, come to think of it, there are also some silly moments, like at the intro. Wow, Zack Attack is such in a big hurry, he forgot to close the door to his secret lair. And he just looked back at it. He just looked back at the door and not bothered to close it. Surely such a wanted individual would be more careful than that. Nevertheless, the screenwriters also give their viewers some clues as to who might have been in the official third Tron film in the series, such as what major characters would be returning. They definitely primed it well enough to start it, that's for sure. If anything, this very well could have been the intro to how the third entry starts. The writing was also penned by director Kurt Matilla and also Robert Auten. You know, I really don't understand why I can't find some really clear pictures of these people. You work in Hollywood, people! Let me find your pictures! Looking at their experience before this, both Matilla and Auten lacked any kind of proper storytelling credits. However, they managed decently here. That's not to say they didn't have big-budget film credentials, though. Matilla served as an editor to the video segments in Iron Man and Sphere, while Auten worked as a visual effects editor in Superman Returns, and then as a writer for the 2014 video game The Vanishing of Ethan Carter.
So yeah, the producers, the writers, and the director don't really have any big positions in other movies, but that doesn't even matter when you have the quality of this production.
Actors and characters. Since this film plays out like a documentary, and it only has a running time of approximately 11 minutes, there isn't much of any new characters the script focuses on. This also means very little development occurs in any way. The appearances by Garrett Hedlund, veteran actors Dan Shore, and Bruce Boxleitner are great to see, but they're more there to help further exposition of the story. Even Jeff Bridges, who only is credited for his voiceover, doesn't provide anything to develop his character.
Evolution will provide us the next step in intelligent life, but it will come from somewhere unexpected.
Besides, for those who have seen Tron in 1982 and Tron Legacy, we all know where Kevin Flynn went to.
You guys know what I'm talking about, right? You know, the cloud? Up there? The big data collection warehouse? Yeah, he's probably taking up all of about 8 kilobits.
And for the role of Zack Attack, the character itself is just a temporary part, and that's bringing his viewers into what the Flynn Lives movement is all about, and nothing more. Still, though, I have to say, hearing the characters talk like they're actually real people and giving their experience while they're there is pretty interesting.
I created a self-monitoring computer security system back in 82. I called it Tron. Well, the weird thing is, Flynn took to calling me Tron. All the programmers ran with it, and the nickname stayed with me for years.
And although most of their lines are exposition-based, hearing them speak about past events is nostalgic. Roy Ram Kleinberg being the one to talk about NCOM.
With Flynn gone, we were no longer in the video game business. It was all corporate. I knew it was over when they brought the cubicles back. I guess getting fired is the best thing that ever happened to me.
You were one of the first NCOM employees.
Oh my gosh. This guy looks like he just said the worst thing that could have ever been said about his own company. Like, do you think he might have been thinking,
oh wait, I don't think I should have said that.
Historical pieces and cinematography. Now, although there are no actual historical references, because the story itself is all fiction, the ability for this little film to sound factual is credible anyway. There's a lot of detail that went into making this feel as close to the start of a movie as possible. Posters and graphic tees with the Flynn Lives logo are just some examples. The stage reporters, timestamps, audio segments with captions highlighted in black, interview clips, and newspaper headlines give the docu-style short a more authentic viewing experience. As the director of photography, Keith Dunkerley helped give this short film its cinematic touch, even though it was only 11 minutes. Much of the time, the camera was steady and had some really great-looking shots when it came to the flashbacks, and also scenes that had detailed panning close-ups on various recording equipment. When it came to the documentary-like end of things, the snippet interview segments stuck to the traditional look of a dark background and the interviewee being asked the questions. It all felt real, as if these characters were real people in today's world. Dunkerley has worked more as a cinematographer, but also has know-how in camera operative positions in films like Funny People, Jonah Hex, Paranormal Activity 3, Project X, no, not that one, and more recently, Straight Outta Compton. Soundtrack and film score. Right when this short begins, avid filmgoers and soundtrack collectors alike will know immediately that Daft Punk is recycling their music from Tron Legacy. Not that there's anything wrong with that, because the tone still matches the setting and it still sets the premise up quite well. There are additional composers in the mix, though. Also listed are Austrian composer Walter Wurzowa and Musik Vergnügen. I'm sorry, what again? Yeah, Musik Vergnügen is actually a music company that Wurzowa belongs to that provides sonic branding such as Samsung, IBM, or Intel. Also orchestral pieces that belong to movies like Troy, and sound design, as to Toshiba or Nike. For any music that is played that doesn't sound like Daft Punk, that would be them. And that doesn't mean the sound changes drastically either. It just doesn't have the theme Daft Punk reuses from their Tron Legacy film score. Wurzowa has also had some significant practice in film. In his early years, he had a chance to compose additional music to the Guilty Pleasure video game movie Mortal Kombat. He also composed the main theme to the Arnold Schwarzenegger film Eraser, and his very own complete composition to Hellraiser 5 Inferno in 2000. That can be found on Discogs.com. As for Tron the Next Day, there was no soundtrack released, but the overall audio quality matches the film's tone and the story with synth basses and progressive strings. I will play the Tron Legacy tracks to some scenes that are played through the short film, and then let the actual film play for the other parts of the score.
Founded around a chess game.
Your plan represented everything Flynn was against.
That spirit totally got away from the top brass.
So we're all writing Flynn off.
Overall impressions. Was it a flub or a job well done? Sadly, this very well may be the only story told after Tron Legacy in the Tron franchise. It may lack any kind of serious development in its characters, although that's expected for a short film, but it makes that up with engaging direction, magnetic music, and writing that preps its viewers of what could have been, or hopefully what may someday be, the continuation of the Tron films.
I'd say let's just keep our fingers crossed.
Yeah, so I think if Disney doesn't start up production on Tron 3 anytime soon, I think that's it. It's not a bad way to start.
and I like it.
You were one of the first NCOM employees.
We'll be right back.